love. is where you are, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My teach my soul to rise to you when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Would you teach my soul to rise to you? Temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And Jesus, you're my hope and my one defense, my Jesus, your grace is my rest. Jesus, your grace is my rest. Oh, your grace is my rest. Your grace Your
Father, we confess that your ways are higher than our ways. Even when we don't fully understand, we believe that the fear of the Lord that you've given us is a grace, the sustenance, the wisdom to carry us through different seasons, to discern your will, to be kept close. So we thank you for these things. You are the one that we trust. You're the one in whom we place our confidence and our hope. Oh, we know that we will not be shaken. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning we will be praying for America as the nation stands at a crossroad, and although there has been much that has been happening to expose and condemn, our posture of prayer today will be one of intercession. So when we stand in the gap, often it's very easy for us to stand at a distance and point fingers and in the same spirit of the world to expose and condemn. But when we intercede on behalf of somebody and for a nation, we are standing alongside them and bringing them before the Lord. And so when we address the Lord this morning, we won't be saying fix them or judge them or bless them, but we will, whether we are American or not, we'll be praying from the standpoint of us. Forgive us, bless us. And so at this time, we'll be worshiping through the word in Isaiah 59. If you have your Bibles with you, I encourage you to open up to Isaiah 59. And as we read Isaiah 59 and pray this over the nation of America, well, keep in mind that although we often prefer brighter, more optimistic passages, it's often against the backdrop of darker passages that the brightness and the hope of Christ can be shown more clearly. And so through this passage, we'll be talking about the depth of our sin, but also our need for Christ as well. So Isaiah 59 reads, "Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. But your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he will not hear. For your hands are stained with blood, your fingers with guilt. Your lips have spoken lies, and your tongue mutters wicked things. No one calls for justice. No one pleads his case with integrity. They rely on empty arguments and speak lies. They conceive trouble and give birth to evil. They hatch the eggs of vipers and spin a spider's web. Whoever eats their eggs will die. And when one is broken, an adder is hatched. Their cobwebs are useless for clothing. They cannot cover themselves with what they make. Their deeds are evil deeds, and acts of violence are in their hands. Their feet rush into sin. They are swift to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are evil thoughts. Ruin and destruction mark their ways. The way of peace they do not know. There's no justice in their paths. They have turned them into crooked roads. No one who walks in them will know peace." So justice is far from us, and righteousness does not reach us. We look for light, but all is darkness. For brightness, but we walk in deep shadows. Like the blind, we grope along the wall, feeling our way like men without eyes. At midday we stumble as if it were twilight. Among the strong we are like the dead. We all growl like bears. We moan mournfully like doves. We look for justice but find none. For deliverance but it is far away. For offenses are many in your sight. Our sins testify against us. Our offenses are ever with us, and we acknowledge our iniquities, rebellion and treachery against the Lord, turning our backs on our God, fomenting oppression and revolt, uttering lies our hearts have conceived. So justice is driven back and righteousness stands at a distance. Truth has stumbled in the streets, honesty cannot enter. Truth is nowhere to be found, and whoever shuns evil becomes a prey. The Lord looked and was displeased that there was no justice. He saw that there was no one. He is appalled that there was no one to intervene. So his own arm worked salvation for him, and his own righteousness sustained him. He put on righteousness as his breastplate and the helmet of salvation on his head. He put on the garments of vengeance and wrapped himself in zeal as in a cloak. According to what they have done, so will he repay wrath to his enemies and retribution to his foes. He will repay the islands their due. From the west, men will fear the name of the Lord. And from the rising of the sun, they will revere his glory. For he will come like a pent-up flood that the breath of the Lord drives along. The Redeemer will come to Zion, to those in Jacob who repent of their sins, declares the Lord. As for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit who is on you, and my words that I have put in your mouth will not depart from your mouth, or from the mouths of your children, or from the mouths of their descendants, from this time on and forever, says the Lord. Father, often in our self-righteousness, we forget that we reap what we sow. We often act in unforgiveness and greed and make decisions based on self-interest. We allow our flesh to dictate our actions. We work overtime to satiate our worldly appetites and appease our guilty consciences. And then we are shocked when we have to bear account of our sins and bear the consequences of our decisions. Our spiritual blindness and hard-heartedness, we often forget that your arm isn't too short to save, that your ears are not dull that they cannot hear. And instead of turning to you for absolution and forgiveness, we choose to pave a crooked path of our own, and all the while wonder why we don't have any peace. And so when we found ourselves up to our necks in our iniquities and dead in our transgressions, and we found ourselves in this place, in your great mercy, your own arm brought us salvation. The justice that would never come, the mercy that was undeserved, the power to overcome our self-fashioned death was poured out with your divine intervention through the person of Jesus Christ. May we turn to him in our depravity. May we look to him for our rescue. In our fallenness and in our nakedness and spiritual bankruptcy, may we turn to him and be saved. We look to you, God. You alone are our hope and our salvation. your truth. Would you soften hardened hearts? Would you open up blind eyes that we would see our need for you? For those who are unrighteous.
Bring us into the knowledge.
When we were dead in our transgressions and our trespasses.
Bring us into the knowledge of you.
Jesus died.
Bring us into the knowledge of what you've done.
Soften our hearts,
Jesus,
to your gospel. Remind us once again of the cost of our sins, the salvation
what
that came through you.
Done.
Let us look to you for forgiveness. Let us look to you
what you've done.
For hope and mercy.
With your arm, you brought salvation and righteousness. You made
away for us.
You brought salvation and righteousness. You made a way for us to be your righteousness. You made a way for us to be the righteousness of God. You made a way.
We were still dead in our transgressions.
For us to be
while you're still blind in our iniquities. While we were still in rebellion, Jesus, you made a way for us. You made a way for us.
Jesus, you made a way.
You paid. for our sin. You died for the sinner. Given us victory.
Oh, you made a way. You made a way. Oh,
you've given us victory over sin and over death.
Turn away, oh,
to turn away from our ways and look to you for our hope.
Turn away from our sin.
Jacob, who repents of their sins and ask for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit who is on you, my words that I have put in your mouth will not depart from your mouth or from the mouths of your children or from the mouths of their descendants from this time on and forever, says the Lord. You have made a covenant with your children. Those who turn to you and those who repent of their sins will see your glory. They'll see the arm of the Lord working salvation on their behalf. Give us the trust and the faith, the grace and the humility to turn away from our own ways and look to you for our hope. Look to you to do only what you can do. Your glory rising up.
justice. In you there is hope for peace. In you we find our salvation. Oh, in you there is hope for justice. In you there is hope for peace. In you we find our salvation.
You're the source of all peace.
In you there is hope for peace. In you we find our salvation.
In the midst of shakings, we look to you.
Let your name be on our lips. Let your name be on our lips, Jesus.
Your name will be on our lips,
Jesus.
Even through shakings and seasons of testing.
Let your name be on our lips.
Your name, Jesus, will be on our lips. May we not forget what you've done for us, Jesus.
Let your name be on our lips.
Let your name be on our lips. Now and forevermore. Jesus, you are our salvation.
Let your name be on our lips. Let your name be on our lips. Jesus.
You are the hope of glory. You are everything that is good and right. Everything that is beautiful and righteous and praiseworthy and excellent. Jesus, may your name always be on our lips.
Let your name be on our lips. Let your name be on our lips. Jesus.
You alone are the redemption.
Jesus, all hope is not lost, for you are our redemption. Jesus, you have said, if my people come and confess, come and repent and humble themselves. If my people pray, if my people pray, then I will come. I will not hold back. Oh, I will come with redemption rain. Oh, I will come.
By my name.
If my people turn away from sin, if my people pray,
if they humble themselves and pray and seek my face.
I will come and I will put my mouth. Oh,
then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin. I will heal their land.
I will come. For I long to have compassion. I long to pour out my grace. If my people pray, I wait to have mercy. I wait to show grace.
save my people who are called by my name. They humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. God, in our need, we look to you. In our lack of solutions, we look to you. Let your people humble themselves and come before a God who's filled with grace and mercy for the repentant. May we trust in your goodness, your kindness that leads us to repentance. Too proud to turn. May we not be so set in our ways and so eager to show that we are right that we cannot turn to you in mercy and kindness. Turn the hearts of your people back to you. In your desire to show mercy, turn your people's hearts back to you, God. Thank you. Trust that you are a God who doesn't stand far off in apathy or disillusionment waiting for your children to turn back to you. But you're a God who continues to burn for his people to turn back to. We trust that you're a father whose heart aches to see his people turning back to him for hope and redemption. In seasons where it's hard for us to discern what your will is or what your plans are, what you're allowing and what you're disallowing, we fall back on what we know to be true, that you're a God who's faithful, you're a God who's just, you're a God who's merciful and kind, and your steadfast love is forever. We thank you, God, that you long to show mercy. You long to bring healing and mending to a broken nation. Heart continues to burn for your people. We thank you that we can trust in these things. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So this time we'll go into a time of intercession for, not for the political process, but we're actually going to be interceding for the American church at this time. And for the sake of unity, we will not be talking about presidential candidates, no matter what side you fall on, and no matter what results come out in a few hours. But this is a time for the church to really be interceding for the bride of Christ to be strengthened at this hour of shaking. So as we pray for the American church, we'll be praying for four different things. We'll be praying for the American church to hear the voice of the Spirit in the midst of all the confusion. We'll be praying for the church to respond in love, even in the midst of different accusations or temptations to compromise. We'll be praying for the church to respond in prayer, where there has been prayerlessness, that God will begin to spark once again a fire for intercession. And then finally, we'll be praying for God to prepare his bride for the season to come, that whatever circumstances come, the bride would be prepared and anchored in who she is in him. Father, we believe that more than ever, these are the days when the church must be able to discern your voice in order to navigate these situations. Even in the midst of so many clashing opinions and prophetic words, we pray that you'd begin to open up eyes and ears to hear your voice. May your church fight to hear your voice and battle against everything that comes against the knowledge of God. We come against a spirit of deafness and blindness, that the church would not rely on secondhand knowledge of who you are and what you are saying, but we pray that we begin to eat the scroll for ourselves. We'd feed on every word from the mouth of God, that it would become our sustenance in this season of confusion. Shatter our preconceived notions, confront our biases, and deal with our blind spots. Father, would you war against blind acceptance of political persuasion, no matter what the side? We pray for clarity. We pray for discernment and divine wisdom in this hour, that revelation and understanding would replace our feeble attempts to speculate on your ways, and even our wicked attempts to use your word to support our agendas. Father, may we tremble at your word. Holy Spirit, may we respond to your leading. May the American church enter into a season of hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Thank you. Romans 13:2 says, "And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing." Father, we repent of our unloving ways. Often in our attempt to defend our position or in our eagerness to be proven right, we resort to boastful and malicious speech, methods that tarnish the witness of integrity of the church. We pray that despite the temptation to tear one another apart, the church would be unified in a response filled with love and graciousness of speech. Not slander, nor gossip, nor unfounded lies. We declare that the church is set apart from the world's ways, that those who are humble will be exalted, those who are last shall be first. We pray for humility of heart. We pray that there would be healing and bridge building where there has been division. We pray for a spirit of self-sacrificing love to become the mark of the church. Teach us to love in the way you do, Jesus, not at the expense of truth, and yet with boldness and confidence. May we not be indicted as a generation of believers who perhaps believed the right doctrines but had the wrong spirit. But may love ultimately be what binds us together as a body. Let's pray. Chronicles 7:14 says, "If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." Father, may the shakings, may the testing, may the trials not be an opportunity for us to turn to hopelessness and futility, but may it be a place, Lord God, where we turn to you in prayer. Jesus, in the same way that you went through the temple courts and you kicked out merchants and money changers, would you purge your house of prayer from a secular spirit that hungers to make a gain and a profit from the business of Christianity? Your word says that in all circumstances we should pray and seek your face. We should turn from our wicked ways. We should be brought to the place of humility, not self-righteous indignation. We repent for our prayerlessness and our hardening of heart. Instead of looking to you for our hope and for our salvation, we repent for the times where we have put our hope in human solutions more than in your sovereign hand. And we ask that as the American church turns to you, that you would hear from heaven and you'd forgive our sins and you'd heal our land. May the turmoil and political chaos bring us to our knees in prayer. May we regain proper perspective regarding the fate of every kingdom that rises and falls according to your will. May we trust in your provision and your power over every situation. As you ignite once again the fire of intercession in your church, may we be reminded that all of this is in your hands. Would you raise up houses of prayer and prayer movements, which encounter men and women on their knees in their private prayer closets with glory and with revelation. Would you raise up praying churches and anoint your people with the gift of intercession? May we not be found asleep in the hour of need, but may we diligently and passionately pursue you in the place of prayer. Let's pray. We'll pray for the church to be prepared for the season to come. Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3 say, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted in streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all he does, he prospers. Father, we come to you in the place of need, and we confess that kingdoms rise and kingdoms may fall, and all nations have gone through regime changes and historical turning points, and yet your commitment and your faithfulness to those who delight in you has never changed. Father, may we face this new upcoming season with unshakable confidence in your supremacy and your sovereignty, no matter who takes up the presidency. You alone are our provision and our sustenance. You alone dictate our rising up and our laying down. You are fully in control. You rule and you reign forever. May your church plant herself in the meditation of your word. May she yield her fruit in its season and not wither, firmly anchored in the truth and in the revelation and communion with you. May we know with sureness that your work through rulers, that you work through rulers over nations, whether Christians or not, you're still in control. And at the same time, may we have more faith than ever in the kingdom that will never end, the King of all kings that will ultimately be seated on an undefeated throne. And may our hope and our allegiance as a church ultimately be to him alone. In the midst of all these shakings, we pray for a stronger, for a more resolved, a more wholehearted and purified church in this upcoming season. A bride that is made ready through times of refining and pruning. A people not afraid of persecution. People not afraid of false accusations or no longer being in the mainstream. A people that will ultimately hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master on that day." Let's pray. Father, we confess that our trust and our hope is in you and in you alone. We thank you, Father, that even in times where it's hard for us to discern what is happening, it's hard for us to see with clarity. Although we see dimly as in a mirror, we know that we will one day see face to face. We pray for wisdom. We pray for courage and graciousness. We pray for love and integrity and perseverance in a day when all these things are being tested. We know that there's a world watching, ready to witness the response of the church in times of chaos and political turmoil. May your bride's testimony be one of Christ-likeness and victory. Where there has been divisiveness and slander, Father, may your church bring mending. Where there have been accusations and polarization, bring your healing touch. May your church pass this test and enter into a season of greater perseverance, greater confidence, greater prophetic accuracy and power in prayer. Holy Spirit, we need you to move. We need you to strengthen your bride. Prepare us for what's right around the corner, not just for America, but also for the nations. None of us are immune to your discipline, your testing, and your challenging. Confront our flesh, inform our minds, soften our hearts, and have your way with your people, that we would look more and more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.